Good morning, everyone. Good morning to everyone here at church and everyone online. We are so happy to have you with us this morning. And I just want to remind you all that today we're going to take communion. So just keep in mind for those of you that are here, we do have some tables set up around the church when that time comes, and we'll all do it together. And those of you at home, we always have a table outside the church office, outside of the building, where you can pick up your communion supplies to take home and have those. But of course, you can always use your own crackers or juice at home as well. But this morning is so beautiful, and I would love for all of you to stand up and worship with us as we praise our Lord this morning.
What holds your heart, what stirs your soul, what matters come to mind? The cares you keep, the thoughts you think, it's not always
stop there.
good to worship together. We're going to just transition here over to another song. And we have Rachel Banfi over here doing guitar and worshiping with us today. Let's give her a hand. I'm so happy to have her here. And I'm just going to get set up here while she's going to play. And Dion is going to lead us in this song. So just let's just enjoy being together. Let's just enjoy getting out on such a pretty day and being able to worship our Lord in this place.
Search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasure that fades are never enough. When you came along and put me back together. Nothing is
God, our Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning for the blessings that you've given us, too many to count, Lord. And we go into this next song. We were talking earlier at the first service about you are our treasure, you are precious, you lift us up, you are our power when we need it. We forget sometimes the power we have in you, Lord, and how big you are. Dear God, we love you. We want to praise you. We pray that these words and these songs come from our depths of our heart, Lord, from our soul, that people can feel your presence here this morning and feel your Holy Spirit working in our lives, God. We thank you for everything you do for us, Lord, and we give it all to you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious tool, more to give up I'd be a fool. You are my
Jesus.
rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my
join me in prayer this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, what a delight it is to be together in your house this morning as we come to celebrate and come to worship. Truly, you are the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And Lord, how precious and delightful it is that we come together to worship you in this time. Lord, we thank you again this morning for your presence in our midst. Lord, as we are reminded of the song that says, when we are alive and well, we need to praise you and give you thanks for the many blessings that you have supplied to us. Lord, this morning we give you thanks for answers to prayer. And Lord, this morning we give you thanks for those who have gone through surgery, who have been healed by your power, and we continue to meet the needs of their body. Pray that you would continue to strengthen them and guide them. And Lord, those who are facing surgery, I pray, Lord, that you be with them today. Guide the doctors, nurses, those who are responsible for them. We thank you, Lord, how you've provided for them in a special way. We thank you, Lord, for Pastor Steve. And I pray, Lord, that you would use him this morning as he continues to give the message on daring faith. Lord, thank you for the words that have been given. And I pray, Lord, that they would be used by your Holy Spirit. You would guide them and direct each heart and life here today, that we would be sensitive to what you've called us to do. Lord, we also want to lift up Pastor Kevin and the youth as they continue to travel, continue to meet today. I pray, Lord, that you would give them safety and bring them back as well. We thank you, Lord, again this morning for how you've undertaken for the needs of the congregation. Lord, continue to supply the needs that are before us. And I pray, Lord, that you would undertake for those who are facing difficulties. Lord, you know each and every need that is represented here today. And we thank you that we can take them to you and you undertake and answer prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness today. Guide and direct us throughout the day and the coming week. We thank you, Lord, that you're aware of what's going on in our lives. And we're trusting you, Lord, today to meet every need and every situation. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, this is a family Sunday, and that means some of our children are staying in our service with us today and kind of learning how to go to big people worship. This morning, before we get into the message, I'd like to invite, if there's any kids here, if you'd like to come down, I have a little message, children's sermon I'd like to share with you. Your parents are welcome to kind of come with you if you want, but you don't have to. It's like you guys are big. You guys are courageous. All right, so come on down and have a seat. Okay, it's good to see you guys here today. You guys doing okay? Yeah, kind of. All right. Okay, well, today we're talking about how we can, we call it plant our lives. Okay, so we're kind of talking about how, well, let me start with this. So I brought this bag. And I don't know, what are they? Apple seeds, okay. Yeah, those are apple seeds. Apple seeds, yeah. All right, so in the Bible, it talks about like how we can plant our lives, and we plant seeds by the good things that we do. And maybe we tell other people about Jesus, or maybe we try to be kind, or we share. We just try to be loving, try to be kind, try to be good, and that's how we plant the seeds. And so I don't know what happens when you plant an apple seed. What happens? It grows, and what does it grow into? Okay, so you plant one of these little tiny seeds, right? If you plant it, it's going to grow into a pretty big tree. Apple seeds aren't real big. I mean, apple trees aren't real big. And eventually, you're going to get apples. I looked it up, and did you know that from one little tiny seed, then if you get a tree, you can get, like, now this is the whole time the tree is alive, you can get between 1,000 and 2,000 apples. Think of that, from that little tiny seed. Like, that's really a miracle, isn't it? Like, start with that. Inside there, like, they're just right in there, yeah. Yeah, he said maybe there's, like, microscopic apples in here, and you plant it, and they get bigger. I think it's all there, yeah. It's all there. That's a good thinking. So, but in the Bible, so it talks about how we're to be, our lives are to be like seeds. And so we plant seeds by the good things that we do, the people that we love, we tell the message of Jesus, we try to be kind, we try to obey our parents, we do all of those things. That's how we plant good seeds. And if we plant good seeds, the Bible tells us that we're going to have a harvest. And a harvest means that there's going to be like apples, or there's going to be fruit that we have, good things that are going to come into our lives because we've been faithful in planting seeds for God. So I thought today that I would bring a little bit of harvest here for us. Ooh, look at that. Nice. Went out to one of the orchards in Smithsburg yesterday, and I'm going to let you this morning, if you want to, before you go, I'm going to let you have an apple, if you like to. They're real apples, yeah. Only thing is, before you go to children's church, I want you to maybe give the apple to your mom, okay? And then you can have the apple after church, okay? If you don't like apples, you don't have to take one. It's okay. You like apples? Yeah. I like them a lot, too. You're 2,000 a billion. Wow, that's how much you like apples? Okay. Yes. All right, but before you go, I want to pray with you, okay? So can we close our eyes? And nobody looking around. Everybody close your eyes, okay? It's kind of how we think about God. Dear God, thank you for these children. Thank you for the life that you've given them. And they can plant the seed, good seeds, of their lives by the kindness, by the good words they speak, by the loving ways they love people, and they try to be a caring person, and maybe pray for people and tell people about Jesus. So I pray that you would help these children to plant the seed of their lives deeply in your soil, so their lives can grow into like an apple, a beautiful, beautiful, tasty fruit. And they can have a good life that will be blessed by you. And thank you that Jesus is our example. And as we take communion, we want to remember a little bit later how good Jesus has been to us, how much he's done for us. And Lord, just bless these children today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so I'm going to put the apples up on the table. And if you want, you can take one and then go back and give it to your parents. And then you can meet, children, let's see. Let's think about this. Okay, the kindergartners and first graders, you guys can be dismissed, but the rest of you stay. Did I say that right? Four-year-olds too, right? Okay. The little ones can be dismissed. I think you know who you are. Keep all that straight. All right, good to see you guys, you big people and little people. Good to see all of you. Yeah, Pastor Kevin and Crystal and the teens are away at youth retreat this weekend, so they'll be coming back this afternoon, so you can kind of pray for them. And I'm sure they're having wonderful weather for this. I'd like to invite you to take your Bibles, and let's turn together to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6. And I'll just remind you right now, at the end of the service, we're going to be taking communion together. And so if you forgot to pick up like a little cup and the wafer as you came in, feel free to get up like right now and go get your communion stuff, okay? That's all right. It's easy to forget that it's Communion Sunday. So there's three places in the back, and just make sure you get those. And I'll just remind everyone, and those of you who are online, this is a good time for you maybe to get your communion juice and cracker, or something for you to take communion with. And you don't have to be a member of our church to take communion, but it is important that you've put your faith in Jesus, you've opened your heart to Christ, and you know him as your Savior and the one who forgives your sins. And so this is a wonderful thing that Jesus has given us to be reminded of what it means to follow him. So we are in this series of messages called Daring Faith, and many of you have been a part of the small groups, and you've been going through the lessons, you're doing the daily devotionals, they've been really good, but we're moving forward, and today we're talking about daring to plant in faith. And we're going to read that scripture in just a minute, but before we do that, the other thing that we've been doing is that we have been going through we've had a weekly memory verse, and I just wanted to throw out a little deal to you. So we have these little pins, and it says, Daring Faith Hero. And so for anybody who can memorize all six memory verses, we're going to give you one of these little pins. You are a Daring Faith Hero. And I'd like to see some of our children memorize these six verses. You have to come, and you have to tell me or Pastor Kevin or Miss Alicia, you have to be able to say it, all six verses from memory, in order to get a pin, okay? So I know you guys are really excited about that, right? Okay. All right, but let's go over the memory verses. These are such good verses, and a wonderful thing to kind of commit them to memory. So let's go back to week one. And I'd like us just to say these verses together. All right, so say it with me. According to your faith, will it be done to you? Matthew 9:29. Okay, and here's the second one that we did. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28, right? The next one. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. 1 Corinthians 2:9. And here's the one for this week. It is one of my absolute favorite verses in the Bible. It's one that I repeat to myself regularly. This is my running verse. When I feel like quitting, I say this verse. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So let's say it together. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Philippians 4:13. We should do that one again. Say it again. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Philippians 4:13. Okay, great. Today we're talking about daring to plant in faith. And as we said with the children, throughout the Bible, there are so many places where it refers to the Christian life as like a garden. And we plant the seed of our life in the garden. And God causes the harvest to come. Let's stand together as we look at the scripture this morning. So the context for this passage of scripture is that the Apostle Paul is encouraging this church in Corinth to take up a special offering. He was collecting funds that were going to go to the church in Jerusalem. It was like where the church all started. And so now they're out in the, you know, other countries, and the gospel has gone out. And they've received word that the Christians in Jerusalem are struggling, probably because they're undergoing persecution. So, and part of that persecution was that, well, people wouldn't do business with you if you were a Christian. It's like you couldn't make a living. And so they're struggling. They're in poverty. And so Paul is encouraging these Christians in Corinth to take up this special offering to help their brothers and sisters in Christ. Okay. Remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, as we read through this, he's talking about an offering, but we also want to think about it, this lesson is kind of in a broader perspective, is that there are a lot more ways that we give than just money, right? So we're going to talk about the whole breadth of the way that God has called us to live a generous life. And God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, he repeats that word, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God because of the service by which you have proved yourselves. Others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. All right, you may be seated. I'm going to go down here real quick and get my water. A little dry today. Throughout the Bible, it talks about the idea that our lives are to be planted for Christ, even from the very beginning. Genesis 8:22, the Bible says, as long as earth endures, there will be seed time and harvest. There are these laws of seed time and laws of the harvest. In Galatians 6:7, it says, don't be misled. No one makes a fool of God. Whatever a person plants, he might harvest. No, not might harvest. He will harvest. It's a law. It's a truth that God has built into our world. So we're looking today at Dare to Plant in Faith. We're going to be looking at God's laws of the harvest. His laws of planting and harvesting, sowing and reaping. If you ignore these laws, your life is going to suffer. You'll be harmed. But if you wisely sow and reap according to the instructions of Scripture, you receive God's blessing. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to get rich. There are a lot of other ways that our lives are blessed other than money. Daring to plant in faith in every area of our lives. So we want to think broadly this morning. So you can use this principle of sowing and reaping in your relationships. You can use it in your health. What you sow, you will reap. You can use it in your finances, on your job, in your career, learning how to plant wisely and how to harvest wisely, for example, in your career. So we're going to go through these kind of quickly. There's a lot of them. I'm just going to spend a little time on each one. I encourage you to kind of follow along and write these down. Number one, everything starts as a seed. Everything starts as a seed. It's the first law of the harvest. Every idea, we kind of talked about this last week when we were talking about imagination, that God plants a seed of an idea, seed of a dream into our minds, and everything that happens begins with that seed in our minds. You think of the United States of America. It started as an idea. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And then eventually became a country. This church, there were a group of people that were meeting downtown back in the 1967, and they got together and had services, and they said, you know, we need a Church of the Nazarene in Hagerstown. And so they brought property at this location in 1968. The youth room was built. It was the first worship center, but it started as a seed, as an idea in someone's heart and mind. Your life started as a seed. Your father's seed was connected to your mother's egg, and your life began. Literally everything on planet Earth came from a seed. It's the truth of Scripture. In Genesis 1, God says, let the land have seed-bearing plants and trees that bear fruit with seed in it according to their varieties. We'll come back to that phrase, according to their varieties. There are just all kinds of different seeds and plants, aren't there? Okay, so what are we talking about when we talk about a seed? I want to give you just a little definition before we go any further. A seed is anything valuable that I give away. It's anything valuable that I give away. When you give away praise or you say thank you to someone, that's giving value. There's value to that. If you give someone good advice, that can be very valuable. When you give your love away and you care about a person, there's great value to that. When you share financially, when you give your money away, there's value to that. Maybe you have experience and you say to a younger person, well, let me show you how to do that. There's value to that. So it's anything valuable that I give away. It can be time, money. I say thank you, appreciation, wisdom, energy, whatever. Words can be seeds that you plant in people's minds. And they can grow and they can bear fruit. That's why you need to be careful what words you speak, especially in talking with the ones that you love, your children, your husband, your wife, your friends. The words that you speak can be either positive or negative seeds. So let me ask you this morning, what kinds of seeds are you planting in your relationships? Are you planting seeds of trust or planting seeds of distrust? Are you planting seeds of kindness? Are you planting seeds of crankiness? Seeds of angerness and bitterness and meanness? Are you planting seeds that build people up and encourage people? Whatever you reap, the Bible says, you will sow. Okay, number two. Nothing happens until the seed is planted. Nothing happens until the seed is planted. The seed must be given away. If you just keep it in a little bag, you know, you got a big bag of seed, it's not going to do any good. Jesus said this in explaining why he came to die. John 12:24, Jesus said, unless a grain of wheat, which is a seed, is buried in the ground, it cannot reproduce. But if it dies, it will produce much fruit. A few years ago, Pam and I went on a vacation up into the Seattle area, and we went to this place. It's called Bruchart Gardens. And one of the great things about your, one of the good things, a lot of bad things, but your kids like move to other parts of the country, you get to go visit your kids and you can stay there for free. So anyway, we were up in Seattle. Our son Ben and his wife Anna live in Seattle. And Ben planned this, our son planned this wonderful tour of like the Northwest. And we went to out to Vancouver Island, and we stayed in an Airbnb out there, and we had some hiking out on Vancouver Island, and we rode the ferries between the islands. And but this one place that he took us was Bruchart Gardens, and Bruchart was a man who many years ago purchased this property and decided he was going to turn it into a beautiful garden. He collected flowers and plants from all over the world. And this is just one of many stunning scenes. If you ever get up in that area, I encourage you to go. Well, one of the things that you could do is, you know, we went through the gardens and when we finished, you know, there's always the gift shop, right? They want to make a few bucks. And so we go into the gift shop and we didn't buy much, but we saw that they had this package of seeds. And it was every year we found out that they'll collect from the flowers a variety of different seeds, and every year they kind of do their own collection of like mixed flower seeds. And so we thought, oh, that'd be cool. Let's buy some seeds, and we can bring them back to Hagerstown, and we can plant them in our backyard, and we'll have some of these beautiful flowers in our backyard. And so we got the package of seeds. It wasn't very expensive, just a few bucks, and we brought it home. And we put it in a drawer. And spring came. And they were in our drawer. And it was just like, this is like 3 years ago. And this spring, we found those seeds in the drawer where we'd put them. And Pam said, I think I'll plant those. I got a place to plant those. So I looked it up, and seeds only last a year or I don't know, maybe two. We said, well, let's try it, you know. Maybe they'll still be good. So she planted the seeds, you know, got it all ready. And it's still just dirt. So nothing happens, right, until the seed is planted. And if you wait too long, I guess that's another part of this we could add on. If you wait too long, it might be too late. You got to plant the seeds, like, now. You know, imagine a farmer. He goes and he gets his seed, buys a big bag of seed, and then he puts it in his barn. And he says, I don't want to use that up. I want to just kind of hang on to that. I might need it. Well, that'd be foolish, wouldn't it? Seeds are meant to be planted, to be given away, and planting and sowing seed is an act of faith. It's when I plant the seeds of my life, I do so believing that God is going to do something through my giving of what he has given to me. I'm not going to keep it in my bag. I'm not going to put it in my drawer. I'm going to give it away and believe that he'll produce some fruit through my life. So as we said in our scripture this morning, Paul is challenging this group of people. He's saying, give an offering. Your brothers and sisters in Christ in Jerusalem are struggling. You know, give this offering. Be generous. And he's saying there's some good things that will happen. Not only will your brothers be cared for, sisters be cared for, but the disunity between, these were Gentiles in Corinth and Jews in Jerusalem, the disunity, the animosity between these two groups will finally be healed. And God will be praised and God will be thanked because of your offering. Planting seeds can be risky because you can't see what's happening below the dirt. Jesus said in Mark chapter 4, The kingdom of God is like someone who plants seed in the ground night and day, whether the person is asleep or awake, the seed still grows, but the person doesn't know how it grows. You know, you don't always know how God's working when you do some act of kindness. You can't always see it until it sprouts, maybe sometime later. When a farmer looks out over his barren field, he doesn't complain, he doesn't gripe. He just starts planting. You know, it wouldn't do any good for the farmer to say, "Oh God, please make my corn crop grow." And God says, "Did you plant any seed?" "No." "Well, don't pray and ask me to make it grow if you don't plant the seed." It isn't going to happen. Sometimes you don't pray, you plant. It's the law of sowing and reaping. All right, number three. What I plant is what I will reap. What I plant is what I reap. This is the law of reproduction. Farmer plants beans. What crop should he expect to get? Not watermelon, right? Beans. If you plant corn in the ground, you're not going to get zucchini. You're going to get whatever you plant. It's a rule of God. It can either work for you or against you. Galatians 6:7 says, "You will reap exactly what you plant." This is a phrase that's used over, there's a phrase used over and over in Genesis. It's the phrase, "after its own kind." It means we'll always reap the same thing that we plant. Now that can be good or bad, right? Whatever I dish out, it's what I'm going to get back in life. And this is a principle that's found throughout Scripture. These aren't on your outline, but I'm just going to go through them quickly. Job 4:8 says, "People who plant trouble harvest it." Do you ever know anybody who planted trouble? Proverbs 22:8 says, "Whoever sows sin reaps weeds." Hosea 10:13 says, "You planted wickedness and now you reap evil." And Matthew 7:2 says, "Whatever measure you use to judge others will be used to measure how you are judged." What you sow, you're going to reap. But then there's also like positive examples throughout Scripture. For example, Proverbs 11:18 says, "The one who sows righteousness will reap a sure reward." And Hosea 10:12, "Plant good seeds of righteousness and you'll harvest a crop of my love." One more. James 3:18, "Peacemakers plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of goodness." So this is throughout the Bible. It's not just some minor message. The laws of the harvest. So think about that. You will reap what you sow in the lives of your children, with your wife, in your work. It'll either work for you or against you. If you sow anger, that's what you're going to get, angry kids. If you sow patience, that's what you're going to get, patient kids. Well, it doesn't always work that way, but you're more likely to. You reap what you sow. Can't sow irresponsibility and reap success. You can't sow laziness and reap reward. You can't sow stinginess and reap a blessing. Galatians 6:7 says, it's in the, this I think is the Message translation, "The person who plants selfishness ignores the needs of others, and ignoring God harvests a crop of weeds. That's all they have to show for his life. But the one who plants in response to God, letting God's Spirit do the growth work in him, harvests a crop of real life, eternal life." You're going to harvest whatever you plant. Okay, so we said, everything starts with a seed. Nothing happens until the seed is planted. And whatever I plant is what I'm going to reap. Okay, here's number four. I'm not the only sower. I'm not the only sower. Other people are planting all around you, aren't they? And you're reaping both good and bad from those who went before you. So some of you, sadly, grew up in families with a history of abuse or a history of alcoholism or maybe a history of divorce. And you have to decide the chain breaks now. Because we can't control the families that we had, but we can control what we do going forward. A Christian guy in college once said to his buddy, four generations of my family all got divorced. And he said, I'm bound and determined that it's not going to happen in my life. The chain breaks now, he said. So, you were affected by what is sown into our lives in our past. And we need to realize that there's consequences not only to the way we live now, but also to how we'll affect future generations. So this series is based on, was developed by Rick Warren, and he tells about how PBS, Public Broadcasting, came to him, and they were doing a series of shows on family histories of famous Americans. And so they did Oprah Winfrey, a bunch of different people. The guy who did it came to Rick Warren, and he said, we want to do a pastor. I want to do a family history on you. And so he said, fine. And so they took a swab of DNA out of his mouth, and they went back, and they traced his family history 1,000 years back. And one of the things that they discovered about Rick Warren is that he has a lot of really godly ancestors in his family. And he said, I am reaping the benefit and blessing from grandparents and great-grandparents who were praying for their grandchildren. I'm reaping that, he said, in my life because I had some people who love God and were praying for future generations. You might say, well, I didn't have a family like that. I'd like to have a legacy like that. But you know what? You can start it. You start it. Start it now. You determine that in future generations of your family, that they are going to be blessed because you're going to plant seeds of prayer and love and godliness and generosity and faith and all those other things. So that the people that come after you will have this blessed family heritage. So you're not the only sower. Jesus said, John 4:38, I sent you to reap where you didn't plant, and others had already done the work before you, and you will now gather the harvest. Think about our church. There was that group of people that met downtown and said, we need a church. In 1968, the youth room was constructed. Think about the people who sowed the good news of Jesus in your life. Were there Sunday school teachers? Were there people who taught you about Christ? Showed you how to live in a way that honors Christ? That's leaving a legacy. Are you leaving a legacy of generosity and faith or of doubt and fear? All right. I'm not the only one sowing. Number five. I always reap in a different season than I sow. Plants take time to grow. There's no instant maturity. You don't plant today and eat the fruit tonight, this afternoon. It takes time. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, the Bible says, there's a time for everything, a season for every activity under heaven, a time to plant, a time to harvest, a time to gather, scatter, and a time to gather. Pam and I love to go out and get to the orchards in Smithsburg and enjoy the cider and the peaches and fresh apples that we have in this area or wherever you get them. But it all takes time, doesn't it? We went out one day to get peaches and they said, oh, they're not ready yet. You got to wait. And so sometimes we have to wait, and sometimes we have to wait even until doesn't happen until after we're dead. and we're dead and gone. And that's throughout the Bible. That happened to Abraham. That happened to Moses. The promise was never fulfilled until after they were gone. All right, number six. I must be patient and not give up. Must be patient and not give up. This is especially important in these days. Galatians 6:9 says, "Let us not get tired of doing what is right, for after a while we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't get discouraged and give up." We got to be patient. Do you ever get tired? I do. You ever tempted to get discouraged and give up? I think we all do. You don't go by your feelings. You go by faith. I'll fill you in on something. I'll make a confession this morning. I don't always feel like being nice to people. And that's a terrible thing for a pastor to admit. I hope you don't think any less of me. Sometimes I just want to be cranky. Just be cranky, you know? Just say, leave me alone. I don't always feel like being kind or generous. There are some Sundays I don't even feel like preaching. But we don't live by our feelings, do we? We live by faith. And sometimes I plant when I'm tired, and we plant when we're distracted, and we plant when we're stressed out. We move ahead in spite of the way we feel. We're tired of pandemic life. We've shed tears and stress and anxiety. So here's a beautiful promise from us. We sung about this earlier. Those who plant, Psalm 126, those who plant in tears will harvest with shouts of joy. They weep as they go out to plant their seed, but they sing as they return from the harvest. Don't give up. Just keep planting good seeds. You'll reap with shouts of joy. Okay, number seven. I always reap more than I sow. So this is a principle of multiplication. We talked about one sunflower seed. One apple seed and thousands of apples. I was thinking about sunflower seeds. You plant one of those, and you know there's like 1,000 of them in the head. Just the head. It's amazing how God multiplies it. Mark 4:8. Some seed fell on good ground and soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, even 100 times. And 2 Corinthians 9:6 says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will reap generously. Each one should give what he's decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. You get to choose how big your harvest is in your life. So I just want to be like just slinging good seed everywhere. And what if we just live that way? Just not sparingly, but generously. And then number eight, the best time to plant is now. Just start. The sooner the better. Don't wait until, I don't know, life is all together and it's easy, or don't say, well, when I retire, I'm going to do this. No, start now. Ecclesiastes 11:4 says, those who wait for perfect weather will never plant seeds, and those who look after every cloud will never reap a harvest. Start doing it now. And number nine, the seed of Jesus is our example. Jesus is the master seed planter. We look at his life. He lifted up struggling people, didn't he? He challenged them with his words. But he also encouraged them. He fed hungry people. He healed sick people. He had compassion on hurting people. He prayed for struggling people. And finally, in his death, he planted the seed of his own life, which he willingly laid down on the cross so that we could experience forgiveness and new life. The closing word of the scripture that we read today in 2 Corinthians 9 says, "Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift." So after Paul says, "I want you to give an offering for your struggling brothers and sisters in Christ," he ends by saying, "But we've been given a wonderful, wonderful gift. A gift that can't be described," and he's talking about the gift of Jesus, who laid down his life for us, who we remember in the Lord's Supper, his indescribable gift in our lives. Well, let's bow our heads together as we prepare our hearts to receive communion today. Lord, we thank you for these laws of the harvest. Thank you for Jesus, who is our example, the one who planted the seed of his life so that we could have eternal life. Lord, as we think about our lives in these times, filled with a great deal of uncertainty, we pray that you would help us to be people who keep planting seeds of kindness, compassion, encouraging words, lifting others up, sharing the good news of Jesus as opportunity arises, seeds of prayer for those we love. Lord, help us to live and leave a godly heritage through the decisions we make and the way that we live. And help us now, Lord, as we join together in receiving the Lord's Supper. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. I'm going to invite you now to get your little cup. And let's take it at this time. You can peel that top little piece of cellophane off. Take out the bread. We are reminded that in the same night that our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, broke it, and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You can eat it now. And then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink together. Let's pray together. God, as we taste the bread and the juice, we want to thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. We want to thank you that he was willing to plant the seed of his life and allow it to die, that the good news of Christ could become a reality inside of us. We pray, God, that you would help us to follow his example through our lives to plant seeds that you can use to bring a harvest of righteousness and goodness in our world that is so broken and so in need of your healing touch. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to join together in singing a closing song.
We're going to do something a little different. We're going to sing along with a video. It's by a group called I Am They, and the song is called Faithful God. We did it with the band this morning, and I hope you really enjoy this song. I think it ties right into the sermon series that we're doing about daring faith, and the words will be up here for you. So let's join together as we close out this morning.
I am surrounded on every side. Can't see the light of day, but I am persuaded beyond all hope. You won't let go of me. I stake my claim on every word you say. You will not be late. I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you with my life. I know my story, it isn't over. Even against all odds, you are a faithful God. You're faithful, God. The darkest of weather, though I can't see, I still believe you're good. So I'm moving forward through crashing waves. I know I'm safe with you. You hold my life, you hear my cry with every breath inside. I will sing through fire and thunder.
Before we go, I want to just remind you of a couple of important announcements. Trunk or Treat is Sunday, October 24th, just a few weeks away. Ashley tells me we have 7 trunks right now, so we could use some more of those. So she's right there and back, and you could see her after service. We also need some other volunteers and donations. Also, we're collecting crisis care kits, and Carol Bryan, who's at the door, can give you information on that. And there's also a need for some supplies down at Reach. And so we're collecting travel size, shampoo, and soap, and razors, though those are just regular size, laundry pods, towels, and washcloths, okay? So if you can bring in any of those things, we will share those things with the homeless people of our community. Let's bow our heads for a closing prayer today. Thank you, God, that you are a faithful God. Thank you that no matter what life brings our way, we can lean into your faithfulness and your goodness. We ask that you would help us now as we go in the power and confidence of your Spirit. Be with those who are at home. Help us all, Lord, to plant seeds of goodness and faith and love and encouragement wherever we go in this world that is broken. May we be planters of your goodness and grace. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. You're dismissed. God bless you.